I'm in the IDE all the time. The tools have gotten so much better. I can push to GitHub, I can pull changes down, I can reference issues on GitHub from the IDE directly itself. It changed the whole game for me.
I'm Richard Campbell from dotnet Rocks and Runez Radio. I'm here in One Estera talking with some of the Visual Studio team about various features in Studio, but not this conversation, because this conversation is with distinguished engineer David Fowler.
Hey.
Now, you're dotnet. I mean, you've been the dotnet team for a long, long time.
15 years.
And congratulations on distinguished engineer.
Thanks.
Very cool.
Thanks.
And well-deserved. How much do you use Studio? Like, you could use any tool in the world to build .NET. Like, is Studio actually part of your suite? Like, what do you use it for?
I use Notepad. No, I'm kidding.
I remember back in the day, the beginning of .NET, we really did use Notepad. There wasn't anything
else. We tried.
Yeah.
But yeah, we use VS every day to build .NET.
Okay.
Actually, the team, I think most of the team uses VS as part of their daily process to commit the product. How we use it is we actually use VS to build .NET, and we put .NET into VS. So it's kind of circular.
Right, because Studio depends on .NET as well.
Right.
There's that, it kind of works both ways. And I think about, there were critical versions, like 2019 and C# 6, or .NET 6, really,
yep.
we're at the hip.
Very coupled.
You needed to use 2019 to use .NET 6, and you needed .NET 6 for 2019.
Yeah.
Like, how do you even build that? That seems like an impossible problem.
It's painful, especially when you have those circular dependencies.
Mm-hmm.
The team has to, inject versions of .NET into VS so that customers can use those versions,
mm-hmm.
and vice versa. And at some point along the line, I think some components in VS took a dependency on .NET 6 itself.
Right.
So now we have to, put .NET into VS so it can use .NET, so we can build .NET to build VS.
You're still working on .NET
6 working on it, exactly.
While Studio's taking a dependency on an early version.
Early versions, that's right. So we dog food both ways.
Wow.
The team actually, as we build .NET, we use preview versions of VS as they come out, and not the ones that you all get to use. We use the daily versions.
Oh, wow.
So every day, a new build comes out, I'll see an update, I'll click on update, hope for the best. It works pretty well. I mean, I was here for 15 years.
Mm-hmm.
I've dog-fooded VS and all the preview versions my entire career. What we have now in the experience is very smooth.
Very reliable.
So we get a new version, it's pretty reliable. I get new features before customers get them.
Yeah.
I get to dog-food them, give feedback to the teams, try out new things. So it's actually a really great way to give feedback to the team that builds VS.
Even for me, I try the new preview editions of .NET in Visual Studio, because it's really pretty painless.
Easy, right?
Well, once upon a time, you would be afraid. Like, I'd almost keep a separate machine for that. If I'm going to experiment with beta bits. But today, even my main dev machine, it's like, oh, I'm going to take preview 3 of .NET 8 out for a spin. Blah, 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 blah. Oh, great, no problem. That's cool. Continue working on my .NET 7 project. No big deal.
Yep. It's pretty funny, because I think maybe 2 years ago, I would have the RTM build and a preview one on my machine, just in case the new build messed something up that I had to get work done.
Right.
Today I'm pretty confident. I actually use one version of VS. I'm like a ninja. I just
Wow.
You know what? Today I'm gonna update to the newest build. See what happens.
Yes.
Worst case scenario, I can go back to the previous build.
Roll
it's not.
Back.
It's not a big deal. So I feel pretty easy getting the new build of VS and working in it daily.
Yeah, and you count on it. Favorite features for you? What's your workflow look like? How do you manage GitHub, for example?
Okay, so one thing, when I first learned Git is a very command line focused tool. So any hardcore dev, you want to use Git properly, use the command line. You want to use all the commands, you want to use Rebase and all the advanced things.
Well, and you were there when the .NET team switched to using
Git. When we first used Git.
Right?
It was TFS, then Mercurial for a few minutes, and then we used Git, right?
Right.
Git 1.
All command line.
All command line. And I remember there were some visual tools, but they weren't in the IDEs and they weren't great yet. And I remember telling myself, as the IDE got better and better, and Git got better and better in the IDE, I would never go from the command line.
Command line god.
Alpha dev, right? I'm coding on the command line, git commit, -am, whatever. I think it was 2019.
Mm-hmm.
The Git tools kind of improved. There was a big leap, and they got redone. And I said, okay, I'll give it a second try.
Right.
And then I would use the command line a little bit, but then for advanced commands, with the IDE to commit and to push. Fast forward to the current version,
2022.
I'm in the IDE all the time.
Yeah.
If the old version of me saw the new version of me, they would be like, what are they doing? Why are you in the IDE trying to commit and push to GitHub? But the tools have gotten so much better. Mm-hmm. I can push to GitHub, I can pull changes down, I can reference issues on GitHub from the IDE directly itself.
Yeah,
it changed the whole game for me.
That's really interesting. And we think about this being happily an IDE person where I want everything in the box there.
Exactly.
That popping to another window is kind of anathema.
Yeah.
I mean, for different developers, they do that all the time, but you know, if you're gonna live in the IDE experience, like that's, you should have everything right there. It's great to see GitHub in the place we need it to be to just make that part of your normal workflow.
Exactly, and it's funny because this year I actually learned I could reference issues by watching a talk, actually by the team, right? I was like, wait, I can do that.
I can do that?
Because I have been like committing, pushing, opening the web page, open pull request, and all that just got close to the IDE. So I was like, I could just do it in one click.
Hey, I just love the idea that a distinguished engineer is still learning features in Studio. Because the rest of us struggle with that all the time. It's like, can I do this? It's like, yeah, since 2015. Oh, okay, now I'll go get in there. But yeah, it happens to you too.
Yeah, every build I like get some videos and I watch a couple, especially one by Mads,
yeah,
where he shows all the features. And I'm just like, when did we do that? I didn't even know. I sent emails and go, okay.
Yeah, that's cool. If you blink, you may have missed it. There's so many things in there. Hey, while I've got you, we're not that far away from .NET 8. Anything you're excited about? Like, you've been working pretty hard.
Oh, yeah. One of the biggest things in .NET 8 that I'm looking forward to is Blazor. Mm. I think it was called Blazor United for
a Yeah, we did a show
for a
on
split
that.
Second.
For a moment.
No, it's called Blazor again.
So this was really, you know, I get to choose. I can switch easily. Run on the client, run
client,
on the server.
Server.
Doesn't make a difference.
Yeah, and I think we are Microsoft, and this is version 3 of Blazor. This is the one that is going to be really good. I promise you this. No, I mean, it was good the whole time, but I really think that this version of Blazor feels like it's completing the circle.
Yeah.
Right? I feel like adding server-side rendering, which we've done in MVC and Richard Pages for ages, so we're good at that stuff. Pulling it together in a way that you can actually blend client and server, it feels unique, and it feels productive again.
It also seems to have really had a huge ecosystem grow around it very quickly, which I feel like we hadn't done in a while.
Yep.
Like everybody got excited all at the same time about, you know, what we could do with this. You could have a set of tools around it. You know, there's a bunch of different things to build. It's exciting to be involved in all of that. But it's also interesting just to think, like, we tease you about the three version thing, but it's also like, that's how you aim.
It's like maturity.
You put out the first bits and you see how people react to it and then you adjust.
Yep.
And that, you know, gets closer, but then that next adjustment's probably the one that's on the money.
Yep.
And it looks like we're there this time.
It is. And I think, you know, having an IDE like VS with frameworks like Blazor, we get to build experiences that transcend just you coding.
Right.
It's the end-to-end experience, how you deploy it, how you publish it, how you build it. And the IDE really builds in that entire end-to-end dev chain.
Right.
It isn't just about doing one thing, it's about the entire experience.
Yeah, it doesn't matter what you need to do. That's your place to debug.
Exactly.
Yeah, all of the different bits.
Yep.
And you guys use exercise every bit of that? Like, does that debugger make you happy too?
Oh my gosh. So I posted this spicy tweet. It was a great tweet. It was probably one of my most viral tweets about, do people still think that printf debugging is better than a debugger? And I got flamed. Obviously, the printf works everywhere. Not everyone has VS and a debugger. But one thing I love to do is whenever I'm in a new code base or trying to solve a problem, I'll put a breakpoint in a piece of code. It'll break. I'll look at the call stack. The call stack is like amazing. It's right there. It's rich. I can debug it to symbols, into external code and sources. And I feel like people don't even know how powerful and great a debugger can be. What we have in VS is kind of amazing.
I feel like we only call it, we call all debuggers debuggers.
Debuggers.
And not realize, like, there's definitely a spectrum of debuggers.
Exactly.
And Studio's debugger is incredibly rich.
Parallel stacks has to be, hands down, one of the best features in the tool. Like, I remember it was, I think, 3 years ago, me and a couple of guys on the team tried to figure out how we can make async debugging easier.
Right.
Because we have been getting crash dumps from teams and, you know, trying to figure out hangs, and it was hard for us to do it. And it was like, okay, what would we need in a tool to help us debug customer issues? And after going back and forth between, you know, the runtime team and the VS team, we ended up with this feature, parallel stacks.
Right.
And the idea was, can we show you a call stack, but for async code? And the team took it to the next level because they can show deadlocks in async code.
Wow.
So now that has become like one of the premium amazing features that I just think is like next to none, right?
When it's something, if you haven't taken it out for a spin, I mean, writing async await is pretty easy to do, But if you really could break into that and watch how the stacks
exactly.
manage for that.
Yeah, it's incredible.
Really educational. Yeah. David, it's so much fun to talk to you. Thanks so much for spending time with us on
this.
I hope this helped you as well. Visual Studio is an amazing tool. David uses it every day, as do I. We'll see you in the next video.